Good morning, Hathor Assembly.
Good morning.
Joy to be in the house of the Lord today.
Welcome to Hawthorne Assembly, and welcome to those who are watching on live stream. And here we are, the middle of July. It's a beautiful day, a little bit of rain in northwest Wisconsin, but we're loving it. And we're just grateful for those who are gathered here this morning. Now, those who are watching on live stream, you don't know if we got every seat filled in the place. Why don't you just believe that today, that every seat at Hawthorne Assembly is filled to capacity. And we're glad that if whatever is the reason you're not able to be here, you are watching this service and being encouraged and blessed by it. And we're grateful for the technology, but we just do love it when people come and gather together. People are even walking through the front doors of the sanctuary right now to enter into the service. Excuse me. And we start at 10:30 on Sunday mornings, whether there's one person in the sanctuary or there's 100. We just want to be able to, for people who are watching our service on Facebook Live or YouTube, they know, oh, at 10:30, Hawthorne Assembly is already starting their worship. And so we're grateful for you who are gathered here, who come here, and we're just grateful for the opportunity to open this service in prayer. And we're just grateful for the worship team behind me this morning that will help lead us and draw us into the presence of God. Amen? Let's pray. Jesus, we thank you. Every one of us has something that's going on in our life today. Every one of us has probably a list of things to do the week ahead of us. Every one of us knows that there'll be work will be part of the equation. Every one of us knows there'll be dishes to do and clothes to clean and things to take care of and things to repair. But we pause right now. We just calm our hearts right now. And we say, Jesus, we are all in for you right now. We're removing from our life the distractions, even the good distractions, things that we know we need to get done, things we know we should do in the next 7 days, this week ahead of us. And right now, we focus in on you. We surrender our wills to you today. We are here for one another because together is better. And today we want you, Holy Spirit. We ask you, we invite you, we honor you, we honor your presence. We recognize your presence. We ask for your great anointing upon this worship team behind me and for us worshipers in the sanctuary and those watching on live stream, that we will worship you in spirit and in truth today. And so, God, we surrender our wills to you. We say, Lord, come and fill this place, inhabit this place with your presence. And thank you, Jesus, that we can spend these next quality moments worshiping, being a blessing to the person to our left and to our right, in front of us and behind us. And God, that later on we'll say it was good to be in the house of the Lord. And so, Lord, right this moment, we surrender and we say, yes, Lord, do what you need to do in each of our lives in your mighty name. Amen. Amen. Let's continue to worship the Lord this morning. Stand if you'd like. If you need to sit, that's fine, but let's continue to worship the Lord.
Down.
we pretend like these fast songs are just a starter. They're just getting people inside the doors, right? But don't do that this morning. Look at these songs we're singing. Look at these words we're singing. It doesn't matter the tempo. We're talking about trading our sorrows. We're saying we're pressed but not crushed. We're persecuted, not abandoned. And it doesn't matter what the tempo of this song is. We're here to worship the Lord. Isn't that right, church? Go back to trading my sorrows. I'm trading my sorrows. I'm trading my shame. Declare that this morning.
Glorious in heaven. The center of it all. Jesus at the center of it all. From beginning to the end, it will always be. It's always been you, Jesus. Jesus at the center of it all. Jesus at the center of it all. From beginning to the end, it will always be. It's always been you, Jesus. Nothing else. Be the center of my life. Jesus, be the center of my life. From beginning to the end, it will always be. It's always been you, Jesus. Jesus, nothing else. Jesus, you're the center. be the center of our church. Jesus be the center of our church. And every knee will bow, and every tongue shall confess you, Jesus.
Just sing the name of Jesus.
Jesus, 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 there's power in the name Jesus, Jesus, oh Jesus, Jesus, oh Jesus, Jesus, nothing else.
Presence, Lord. If you've come in here with a heavy heart, or even the exact opposite, a heart full of optimism, just be thankful that God's presence is here. He's as close as the mention of his name. Corporately, we've done that this morning. We've declared the goodness of our God. We've declared unashamedly that Jesus is the center of our lives. It's all about him. And yet in that moment of understanding and revelation, we see our own lives, not in a selfish way, but saying, yes, God, be the center of my life. But at this moment, God, I need a touch from you. There are those out in this audience and those watching on live stream that need a touch from Jehovah Rapha, Jehovah Sitkenu, Jehovah Mikadesh, Jehovah Shalom, Jehovah Jireh. And God, today you are the center of our lives. And we know that it's in you we live and move and have our being. And today we need a touch from you. Today my wife Janet needs a touch from you in her body. She needs healing in her body. Today, my dad and my mom, they need the comfort and the peace that passes all understanding. Even in their brokenness, even in their broken cognitive life, God. They need a touch from you. Outwardly, they are wasting away, but inwardly, they are being renewed day by day. And that's a word for even someone in here today. You're broken down. You just feel exasperated and exhausted. And you just need a touch from heaven this morning. And he is as close as the mention of his name, even the whisper of his name. Like the woman with the issue of blood that said, if I could but just touch the hem of his garment. He's here, folks, dear people. He's here. We continue to pray for people today. Lord, we are just grateful today. It's all about you. It's all about you and like the song we sung earlier, that we'll never know the cost. We'll never know the depth of the pain that we each created in your life, but you took it to the cross. You bore our shame. You bore our guilt. You bore our iniquities upon that cross. And today we're free and forgiven. And the monkey's been taken off of our back. The devil has no right to us. But yet, God, even in our frailty of life, in our brokenness, we still draw near to you. We cry out to you. We desperately need you, God, in our lives this day, this Sunday, this middle of July of 2023. We need you, God, to show yourself strong and mighty on behalf of uplifted hands, uplifted hearts, people who are watching on live stream, people who just need a breakthrough in their life, God. We are believing for it. We're agreeing together. We are realizing we're not just here for ourselves. We're here for our brothers and sisters and those who are maybe even outside the kingdom, but maybe today's the day they say yes to you, Jesus. Maybe today's the day someone comes back into the fold today. Maybe today's the day that a marriage is mended. Maybe today's the day that some child that's been wayward comes to his senses and says, yes, Jesus, I'm returning. Yes, home. Thank you, God, today. You're a miracle-working God, and we thank you for it. And all God's people said amen. Let's pray as we receive the tithe this morning. Jesus, thank you for this gracious, wonderful, generous, giving congregation. We're grateful for their faithful support week in and week out. Bless now the gifting giver in your name. Amen. God bless you as you give. I, of course, rushed to Wilmer a few days ago thinking that my father may be on his way to be with Jesus. He still is on his way to be with Jesus, but I thought it might be happening immediately. His heart rate at one time was 29 beats per minute. His oxygen saturation was down to in the 70s. You know what those things all mean. Life is coming to a closure. He's almost 88 years of age. He's about today, as a matter of fact, he's born on August 23rd. 23, 1935. You do the math. So about 30 days from now, he'll be 88. And I don't know how much longer he has. All his days are ordained before ones come to pass. We just keep praying for him. And he's in comfort care / hospice now. And some of you have asked how he's doing. Well, he is kind of in and out of not consciousness. He's just not aware of his surroundings. We were with him this weekend, Aaron and Katie and the granddaughters on their way back to Butler, stopped through Wilmer, and we visited. It was challenging, but hey, life's not easy, and death is not easy, and end-of-life things are challenging, but God is good all the time. While we were there, we stopped at a restaurant and had lunch. I had invited my brother who lives in Wilmer to come and join us. And the gentleman outside there had a little couple tables set up outside this little cafe. And he looked at me and he just said, man, I'm just impressed by you. He says, you live 5 hours away and you're here all the time. I said, hey, I said, it's the fifth commandment. Okay, fine. But I'm just impressed. I said, no. I said, my flesh doesn't want to be here all the time. But it's the fifth commandment. Honor thy father and thy mother. Because in a small, selfish way, it says that my life will be blessed. by my faithfulness. So 90% of it, I'm doing it out of obedience. I'm just being transparent with you, okay? Because I'm no better than any of you. I'm just trying to do my part. I'm trying to be faithful to the Word of God, faithful to my parents, love of my parents. I don't want to be there all the time. There are moments I don't even want to think about taking more of the things and emptying the house and all that kind of stuff that we are finishing up. But it's just part of life. And God will give us the strength if we'll draw near to Him. They that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength, right? And so with that in mind, why don't we turn in our Bibles to Philippians chapter 4. We're going to stand in just a couple seconds, but why don't you turn there and get there, a very familiar verse. Philippians 4, verse 8. Our title today is, What's Up? And I was thinking about this message as it came to me a few weeks ago about how we respond to people in all aspects of life as a follower of Jesus. And I thought that this would be a good thought for today, even as I am, and of course Janet, we are challenged by what we are living with as far as loving on our parents. Her mother is 88 and is struggling with a few items in her own life, and my mother is 86, and as I just alluded to earlier, my father is almost 88. But life is always interesting, and God never promised that it would be easy. And so with that in mind, stand with me this morning. Let's honor the reading of God's Word, Philippians 4, verse 8. And now, dear brothers and sisters, one final thing. Fix your thoughts on what is true and honorable and right and pure and lovely and admirable. Think about things that are excellent and worthy of praise. And before you're seated, here is a companion verse. If you could just quickly turn, it's not very far away, in the book of Colossians chapter 3. Let's look at this verse and let's make this a companion verse to our primary verse for our sermon today, What's Up? And that is Colossians 3:17. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through Him. Amen? Let's pray. Father God, thank You that Your Word's a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. Today we want You to allow Your Word to change us, to correct us, to motivate us, to encourage us, to stimulate us, to move us forward in our walk with You. In Your name, amen. You may be seated. Paul is telling the churches in Philippi and Colossae, he says, we church, like we do here at Hawthorne Assembly, we need to be fully committed to the Christian life. Fully committed to the Christian life. And it starts, this is what the Apostle Paul says, as he even ends, he says, finally, that's a good word, that's an important word, finally, it starts in our thought life. We've talked a lot about sermons like this. These are critical sermons. These are important messages because our thought life is being bombarded every day by things that are not beneficial. We had to turn off. Now, I'm not endorsing one station over another. I'm just stating the facts. We were listening to Fox News. And it's not always uplifting. They were talking about some graphic things, about things that were happening when they found this serial murder just recently in New York. Y'all heard about this? This is some graphic stuff. I won't even venture into the details. I said, honey, we got to turn this off. This is just, it's not good on my thinker. I don't want to think about these things. They're not worth my thinking. That's why when people share rumors or stories about other people and you don't know if they're correct or not, Now you got to decide in your thinker, is this right? Is this wrong? Is this accurate? Are all the details correct? You've seen the game people do where they whisper something into the first person's ear, and then by the time it gets to the 10th person, it's completely some different story. I don't want my mind to be bombarded by these things that take time to decide, okay, did that really happen? Did that person really say that? So I need to work extra hard. I don't know about you. Excuse me. But I need to work extra hard at staying focused on the Lord, especially with everything I'm dealing with. We were with my parents, of course, this weekend at the emergency room. And my dad had his probably most alert, alive moment when we got there. He was so kind. It's probably the best communication I had with him in half a year. And he was, oh, thank you, Joe. Joe, I'm so glad you're here. Thank you, Joe, okay? And then the next day, a bunch of family showed up because I told him, I said, you better come because he's not long for here. So they're all, his sister, his 85-year-old sister shows up. Some of my cousins show up. My two brothers are in there. Janet's in there. There's a bunch of us in there, okay? And we had a nice conversation. My dad was still fairly awake, cognizant of what was happening. And then everybody started leaving. And I had to walk out of the room for just a second because Janet had asked me a question. And there was just so much noise, it was hard to hear it in there. So we stepped outside to have a small conversation. And I heard my brother, Joe, you got to get in here. And I go back in, and my dad has just like a switch has flipped. And he's saying, I got to get out of here. You've got to take me home, Joe. Joe, I need to go home. I mean, and it went on for 20 minutes, and I'm consoling him. And at one point he goes, Joe, you're pathetic. Now, those things hurt because you don't expect your dad to say them about you, okay? There's been a couple times in this last year of life he said things kind of like that. And you can't let it get to your heart. It'll ruin you. That's why it's so important. It is so important based on our passage. You fix your thoughts on what is true and honorable and right and pure and lovely and admirable. Anything that is excellent and worthy of praise. You got to think on these things because the world's going to throw you some curveballs, even your dad. And so a little later on, he said, oh, Joe, you're not pathetic. You're okay, you know. But I realize I'm talking to a broken individual. And so you have to learn how to be able to deal with individuals who are going to say things mean-spirited, things that might come out that you never expected, and you need to be prepared for those kind of comments. And you won't be prepared. You will not be ready if you're not dwelling on the Lord. If your thoughts are not engaged in His presence, in His Word, in what the Spirit of God is downloading into your life, being with other believers who speak positively about the things of God. And so that's why I chose this phrase, what's up? Because it's a very common thing that we hear people say to us. What's up? What's up? And we usually respond. And I would ask you this. How many of you, and I experienced this more than any other place when I was in the environment of Minnesota Adult and Teen Challenge. I can't say that I experienced this at a local church, at another ministry that I've been involved with in my life, but I did experience this at Minnesota Adult and Teen Challenge. I'd greet someone or they greet me, and I would say, well, how are you doing, or whatever, and often the answer would be, I'm blessed. I'm blessed. I'm blessed. Now, if that was just a standard answer like yes, sir, no, sir, that may not be anything other than being polite. But if it's from deep within our core, deep within us, that's a wonderful thing. And so I'm going to ask you, how do you respond to people when they greet you and they say to you, what's up? Are you complaining? Are you thinking all of a sudden about things that are wrong in your life or what you're dealing with or the people who have wronged you or whatever, the people who've told you you're pathetic? Or are you thinking higher things and godly things and noble things? Possibly the reason is we have our own personal thought life in places it shouldn't be too often. And that's why when things happen and things are said, we don't have the correct response. And I want to be victorious in this area of my life, in my thought life. I'm not always victorious because I think bad things about people. So if I think bad things about people, and not because I'm a pastor, but because I'm a human, I believe everyone else is challenged by this same thing. How they think about people, how they think about their spouse, how they think about their children. I don't think that based on our scriptures that you're supposed to just have your mind 24/7 fixated, like, okay, all I'm thinking about is the Lord, because you do have to go to work. You do have to engage conversations. You have to study at certain times in your life. There are things you have to do that need and require your attention. But what we're saying is, in those moments of where that may not be what you're dealing with, you need to have a lifestyle of that 24/7 you are thinking about the Lord when you can. Do you understand what I'm saying? When you can. Now, you can think about the Lord at work. You can. Now, you don't want to get, you're there for a job, so you pray before you walk in, Lord, if you need to speak to me, you speak to me. Amen. But I'm here to work for the kingdom of God and for you and to be a blessing to my employer, and I'm going to do my very best. I'm not going to allow my lifestyle or my words or my communication to insult your kingdom. So let's think of three things this morning. Here are three things from our passages, that I want you to be challenged by. I want you to contemplate these things. I want you to dwell on these things. And here they are. Point number one, we are a summation. You know what a summation is, right? The sum of things, the total of things, everything lumped together. We are a summation of our thoughts, which manifests itself through our words and actions. We are a summation of our thoughts, which manifests through our words and actions. Yeah, you're a three-part being, body, soul, and spirit, and the incubator, the microprocessor, everything that you're going to spew out is going to begin in your thought life. Now, as I was writing this, the only thing that maybe where that doesn't fit in perfectly is if someone were to walk up to you and stick a taser on your back, you might immediately scream out loud something, and maybe not even appropriately. But, I mean, you're not thinking about that. I mean, there are reactionary things. You stub your toe, you run into something. Obviously, those are reflex, kind of just knee-jerk reactionary things. But we're not talking about those kind of things. We're talking about the overwhelming part of your life where you have an opportunity to consider what you're about to say, where you have an opportunity to think about how you respond to, what's up? What's up? How do you respond? What's the first thoughts out of your thinker? We need to live 24/7. This is a good statement. We need to live 24/7 with a divine awareness. A divine awareness of where our thoughts are dwelling. Okay, God, you're right. Late at night, even at the workplace where things are difficult at work, where my boss is really not nice, That doesn't give you the opportunity to get to go south and to pray that the fleas of 1,000 camels invade his bed tonight, okay? Doesn't give you that right. You have to have a divine awareness 24/7. Where's God in your life? And how is he impacting your thought life? You can't say, oh, I just switch him off. I'm only godly and amen and praise the Lord from 9:30 on Sunday morning till about 1 o'clock. And then I switch her back off and I'm back to being blue and cranky and not nice to people and obstinate, rude to my spouse, rude to my children, bossy, hard to live with. Church, we need to protect our thoughts. Our words, listen, this is a little different from that last statement I said about having that divine awareness. Our words and deeds, words spoken, deeds, actions, they arise from only one place, our thought generators and the decisions we make. Choose this day who you will serve. It's all happening up in our thought. Listen to what first, turn to 1 Chronicles 28, 9. 1 Chronicles 28, 9. And you, my son Solomon, acknowledge the God of your father and serve him with wholehearted devotion and with a willing mind. For the Lord searches every heart and understands every desire and every thought. What does he understand? Every desire and every thought. If you seek him, he will be found by you. But if you forsake him, he will reject you forever. David is telling his son Solomon, don't let your thoughts wander. Don't let your thoughts go sideways. Hello, is anyone there? What's up? Serve him whole, that's W-H-O-L-E. That means all of you. Wholeheartedly, willing mind. You know what a willing mind is? That's a mind that's focused and engaged. That has a mind that has a divine awareness that helps to filter what you're thinking about 24/7. At work, in the truck, at the beach, at home, what you're watching on television, listening to on the radio, wherever you are. Amen? Proverbs 4 says this. I love this. You should highlight this in your Bible. Proverbs 4, chapter 4, verses 23 through 26. Let's read it together. Here we go. Keep your heart with all vigilance. That's a big word, that word vigilance. That's where we get the thing vigil. You know, that's where people get and they have a prayer vigil. Vigilance is that's like this intense, fully engaged, fully connected, excuse me, fully aware of what's going on. Keep your heart with all vigilance, for from it flow the springs of life. Put away from you crooked speech, and put devious talk far from you. Let your eyes look directly forward, and your gaze be straight before you. Ponder the path of your feet, then all your ways will be sure. That means before you even take a step, you better pause and make sure you're going the right way. See, there's no neutral in the kingdom of God. You can't just be neutral. Think, I'll just idle. I'll just get by. There's no getting by. There's no cruise control. Vigilance means you are completely alert, fully awake, fully engaged, starting in your thought life. It reminds me of another verse from 1 Peter 5:8, it says that the devil is out there like a what? roaring lion. And it says to be on what? Alert. To be on guard. You don't think the devil won't use your speech against you? You don't think? So you got to be careful. Because the devil is not your biggest fan. He's out to kill, steal, and destroy. Let's read our main verse again from the ESV version. I like the ESV version. I like the NLT. I like the King James, the NIV, the NASB. But listen to it from the ESV. Let this soak in. Finally, well, there's that word again, finally. Brothers. Now, of course, this doesn't say sisters, but it means for you sisters too. Whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Hey, Hawthorne Assembly, what's up? I hope when I said it that time in your mind, you said, oh, Pastor, I am blessed. I'm blessed. I'm blessed. I'm blessed beyond the curse. I'm blessed. I don't mind driving 5 hours to Wilmer because I'm blessed. And God is my source. This Christian stuff is not just for when it's easy. It's really for when it's difficult, when life throws you curveballs and you have things you have to do. And I'm so blessed to have a congregation that has been so gracious towards Janet and I and being able to go there at a moment. I may have to go there again this week. I'm telling you, he's on hospice. And God bless these people who are part of hospice. Let me just tell you, I want to speak praise about this hospice thing. I'd never really been involved with it before, but they have been so kind and so nice. And the chaplain called and said, I went and visited your father. And he said, I just want you to know, he goes, I'm of the Catholic faith. I believe he's a deacon. He's not a priest, but he's a chaplain. I said, hey, you know what I said? Catholics stay out. No, I said, hey, as long as you are a follower of Jesus and Jesus is the center of your life, go visit my dad. All right. He didn't give me an amen, but that's okay. He said, all right. He said, I'm just there to love on your dad. I'm there to encourage him and tell him, Jim, let's just take it one day at a time. And he prays for him. Blesses him. Whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. I would encourage you that if you don't listen to, whether it's not KTIS up here, what's the name of the radio? I just call it KTIS. Okay, but 97.3, right? Or whatever you want to listen to. Boy, put on some worship music. Don't always listen to Fox News, even though I'm a big Fox News supporter. Turn that sucker off. Put on some worship music. Fill your house with the praises of God. Amen. Put on old hymns. Go to bluegrass, gospel bluegrass concerts, and fill your thinker with these things that Philippians 4:8 says you should be filled with and thinking about. Amen. Turn off the junk. I like TV. I like cop shows. I like Blue Bloods. But a regular diet of that would make me cranky. You can't stick it in and think there isn't going to be some outflow. Here's another thought. You know how they say it takes so many days to form a habit, right? You've heard that before. The flip side of protecting our thought is this. Repeated actions and repeated speech affect our mindset that come out of our own mouth. Repeated actions and repeated speech that come out of our own mouth affect our own thinking. If you've ever read anything by Watchman Nee, you'll realize that's where the battle is, the battleground of the mind, the battle of the soul versus the spirit. And the Bible talks about that the Word of God is able to divide the joints from the marrow. The soul from the spirit is the discerner of the thoughts and the intentions of a man or a woman's heart. Amen? We are in a battle. And this is the battleground, because I just heard as I was driving over here, Fox News just happened to be on the radio as I was driving here this morning. I'm being transparent. I should have had worship music on, but maybe the Lord wanted me to hear this one thing. Did you know that 40% of our society now, they just did a survey. I don't know which group it is. I don't know if it's the millennials or the Gen X or the Gen Zs or who it is, but they're saying that there should be, it should be a criminal or a civil offense if you don't address someone by their proper pronoun. Do you know what I'm talking about here? It's goofiness. You do not want to just watch Fox News. You don't want to just read U.S. News and World Report and your local newspaper and your local Good Town television station and think that somehow you'll be well-versed for life. That will not fare you well. You need to be in the presence of God, whether it's prayer or the word or worship. You need to fill your home with the things that have eternal significance. Amen. I'm not telling you 3 hours of this, 1 hour of that. There's no formula, but you got to make sure that your information that comes your way and the things that affect your thought life have eternal values attached to them. Amen. I just read the Imprimis. How many of you get the Imprimis newsletter from Hillsdale College? Isn't it great? It's fun. You should read the last article from Hillsdale College. It's actually the bishop from the Winona, Rochester Diocese, Catholic guy. But let me tell you, he spoke at the commencement exercise for Hillsdale College just this last May, and he was talking about the things I'm talking about today, the battle that we're in, the battle of our thoughts, the battle of what these young people are going to have to deal with and make decisions on based on the society they're going into as followers of Jesus. And it was just brilliant what he talked about. So if you get the Hillsdale College, it's free. They'll send it to you every month free. It's called Imprimis, Hillsdale College. Ask Dave back there. He can tell you all about it, right? And it's a great article, no charge. They'll send it to you, and you'll want to read the one from this month, from July. It's excellent. What we do and say shapes and forms future habits, even affects our thought life in the future. What we say, what we do. In other words, our thought life can be benefited by how we hear our own self speaking out loud through our own ears that goes back into our soulish realm. That's why I just was, at first I wasn't used to it, hearing these people, how you doing? I'm blessed. How many of you hear that on a regular basis from when you do? That's good. That's the exception, not the rule. It should be the rule. But I don't hear that very often. Well, how you doing? What's up? I'm blessed. I'm blessed. Amen. Now let me bring balance to this message this morning. You might be going through a very difficult time right now. And it might be hard to form those words to say I'm blessed, because things are overwhelming in your life. Maybe it's physically, maybe it's mentally, maybe it's emotionally, or maybe it's a relationship. And during these challenging times, this is where God shows himself strong in our life and in our thought life. Do you know it says he's near to the brokenhearted? Where does brokenheartedness, if I can use that term, start? He's near to the brokenhearted. He's not near to you just because you go, God, life sucks. He's near to you because he senses your pain. He senses what you're thinking about, what you're overwhelmed by, your fears, your anxieties, the things that intimidate you, all those things that we deal with, each and every one of us as followers of Jesus. And so in those difficult times, during these challenging times, this is where our thought life needs to be strong. This is where our previous years, our previous months, our previous weeks of making sure that we protect our thought life will help us in these difficult moments when God doesn't make sense, when heaven doesn't seem to be responding, when miracles don't seem to be taking place, and when your dad says you're pathetic. And how do you deal with that? I realize it now. I remember a few years back, I said to all my children, oh, Lauren's out there somewhere, right? I'm just looking for her. I'm pretty sure I said it to all of my children. You really disappointed me. Now, when you say that to someone, especially a child, you don't realize the overwhelming heaviness and that puts on people, whether you call it guilt or shame or whatever. And I took my dad saying it to me in his great brokenness about 3-4 months ago. He said, Joe, I'm so disappointed in you, because he wanted to go home. He was having one of those I want to go home again moments. And he said, I'm just so disappointed in you, Joe. And it ate at me for about 10 minutes. And I had to say, God, you have to help me, Lord, because I didn't expect that from my dad. Do you think our children expect that from us when we say things like that? I'm just so disappointed in you. It just beats on their soul. And now they got to deal with this. So we need to make sure our thought life is right, so that in those moments, in the crucible of life, in the fire of life, and in these challenging times, you'll shine like stars. You will say the right things. You won't mess up. And if you do, you'll have enough integrity to go to that person and go, I'm so sorry. I didn't mean to say that. I wasn't thinking right. My thoughts weren't eternal. I was reacting out of my flesh. Please forgive me. Amen. Psalm 139:4 says, even before a word is on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it altogether. God wants to help you with your speech. Don't say, well, that's how I've always talked. No, God wants to help you. Do you believe that? God wants to help you. He'll help you with your words, because it starts in your thoughts. God wants to help you to be the best communicator for his kingdom that you've ever been. Listen to what it says in 1 Peter 3:10. Whoever desires to love life and see good days, let him keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Wow. I want to sometimes snap back. Anybody else? Anybody else in here with me that I want to snap back? When somebody says, I want to snap back. I do. I want to say some things once in a while. Because my flesh, it rears its ugly head. Listen to this thought from James Allen from his book, As a Man Thinketh. Here we go. As the plant springs from and could not be without the seed, so every act of a man springs from the hidden seeds of thought and could not have appeared without them. This applies equally to those acts called spontaneous and unpremeditated, as to those which are deliberately executed. In the armory of thoughts, he forges the weapons by which he destroys himself. He also fashions the tools with which he builds for himself heavenly mansions of joy and strength and peace. Between these two extremes are all the grades of character, and man is their maker and master. Man, you and I, is the master of thought, the molder of character, and the maker and shaper of condition, environment, and destiny. You can't say the devil made you do it. I just added that. Let a man radically alter his thoughts, and he will be astonished at the rapid transformation it will effect in the material conditions of his life. You choose. Choose. Men imagine that thought can be kept secret, but it cannot. It rapidly crystallizes into habit, and habit solidifies into circumstance. Isn't that a great excerpt? James Allen, "As a Man Thinketh." Proverbs 16:24 says, "Gracious words are like a honeycomb, sweetness to the soul and health to the body." Our words bring life. They even bring life to our thought life. That's why when you quote the Word of God out loud, it benefits you. Let no corrupt communication proceed, right? You ought to just take that verse, put it somewhere prevalent in your home, read it out loud every day. I guarantee you it'll change you. I guarantee it will change your thought life and the way you speak. Our words bring life, even life to our own thought life. It has whole body benefit. What's up means you should be thinking up every time someone asks you what's going on in your life. Every time there's a conversation with someone else, your spouse, whoever, your thoughts should be directed towards heaven. Not only in your head, not only in your heart, but in your hands, what you're going to do. Amen? Matthew 12, turn there quickly as we wrap this up this morning. Matthew 12, 36 through 30. Here it is. This is a sobering passage. Sorry, people. I'm not sorry. You know, a buddy of mine, when I worked in the secular world, he used to say, "Sorry, but I'm not sorry." A little play on words, right? Sorry, but I'm not sorry. In other words, you need to hear this. Sorry, but I'm not sorry. That I got to tell you what the Word of God says. It says in Matthew 12, 36 and 37, "I tell you, on the day of judgment, people will give an account for every careless word they speak. For by your words you will be justified, and by your words you will be condemned." And it all starts in our thoughts. It seems as if your words matter to God. He's keeping a record of them. Let's learn how to have a divine pause going forward when someone comes to us and says, "What's up?" Next week we'll finish this. It's a two-parter. We'll give the last part of this, "What's up?" And then, of course, Roger Albanese will be with us the following week. I encourage you to be here for Roger Albanese. He is in his late 70s, and he is such a man of God. As a matter of fact, I just called a guy the other day. I emailed him, excuse me. His name is Alan Langstaff. And he once again, he's another great guy. If you ever wanted to read some great things on the internet to improve your thought life, he's got the Langstaff letter. Come see me. I'll tell you about it. You can get it. It's just free off the internet, of course. He just had a great article, and I read it. And so I emailed him, and I said, "Alan, this is Joe. You want to come and preach at our church?" I love old guys and gals who have been with the Lord for a long time. They need to be behind pulpits more often than the 24-year-old. I'm just being honest. Nothing wrong with the 24-year-old. But it's the 88-year-old who's been in the Word all his life. You got to hear from him before he goes to be with Jesus. Do you understand what I'm saying? Or the 78-year-old, or the 68-year-old, or the 58-year-old. I want to hear more from them than I do the 22-year-old. They haven't lived long enough. But I love the 22-year-old who's a follower of Jesus and excited for the Lord. You see what I'm saying? I'm not saying to negate them. I'm saying make sure you're listening to those seasoned veterans that give the word of the Lord, amen? And so I said, "Alan, would you come?" He goes, "Oh," he goes, "if I was 10 years younger, I'd be there." He said, thank you so much for the invite, but I have to turn it down. I missed out. You all missed out on hearing Alan Langstaff. But maybe you want to read the Langstaff letter. He sends it out about once every 3 weeks. It's a wonderful article. Man of God, came from Australia, pastored an Assembly of God church in Minnesota for a few years. Does anyone else know Alan Langstaff? Great guy, isn't he? Yeah, 88 years old, serving Jesus still. Bow your heads with me this morning. What's up? Amen. You're blessed. Lord, thank you for today. Thank you that on this Sunday in the middle of July, we are thinking about our thought life. And we're thinking about how we want to have that divine awareness of our thought life 24/7. So Lord, help me. Help each individual in here today that maybe they struggle with their thought life. Maybe they struggle with the responses that come forth from their lips because their thought life needs help. Lord, I believe today that you will help these people. You promise in your word that you'll help us. You promise that you can help us so that we can walk in victory over these things. And God, we need it. I need it. I desperately need it right now, Lord. I need my thought life to stay strong. Even with everything that's happening in my life, everything that's happening with my parents, everything that's happening with Janet's mom, all the things that we're not able to really control, God, everything that's happening in the world itself, that because God, you've called me to be a shepherd. You've called me to be an under shepherd. And I need your help, God. I need your thoughts. I need to have pure motives, right thinking, God. So I'm praying for each individual in here today the same thing. They want to have right thinking, pure motives, right thoughts. So the next time someone says what's up to them, the response of their heart will be, I'm blessed. I'm blessed above the curse. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Greater is he that is in me than he that is of the world. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. And every tongue that rises itself up in accusation against me shall be defeated. Thank you, God. I've hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. Yes, God. Thank you, Jesus, today for your word. It is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. You've set life and death before us. You've told us to choose life. So God, we choose life today. If any man is in Christ, he's a new creation. God, we believe that today. We believe your word says that the old has passed away, the new has come. Yes, God, we thank you today. We thank you today, God, that we were fearfully and wonderfully formed. We are fearfully and wonderfully made. All the days of our life have been ordained before one's come to pass. We believe what your word says about us. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our life. God, we believe these things. We believe these things. Thank you, God, today for your word. Lord, today we just pray that you'd help each individual in here in this area of the battle of their thought life, that they're going to be victorious. They're going to lean on you like never before. Today, God, I lean on you like never before. As you say, lean not on our own understanding, but in all our ways. Acknowledge you. We thank you for that, God, today. Stand with me this morning. Brandy's going to lead us in one last song. The altars are open like they always are. You're welcome to come to this altar for any reason. We'll be happy to pray with you. God bless you.
I'm actually going to start with the bridge of this song today. Sing, I am blessed. I am called, I am healed, I am whole.
I am blessed, I am called, I am healed, I am whole.
Suffering, Lord, I will remember. How you are
highly favored, anointed, filled with your power, for the glory of Jesus' name.
Even when you don't feel like it,
I am blessed, I am called, I am healed, I am whole, I am saved in Jesus' name,
by the blood of the Lamb.
Filled with your power,
for the glory of
Jesus' name. I am blessed, I am called, I am healed, I am whole, I am saved in Jesus' name. Highly favored, anointed, filled with your power.
Time.
God, you're